everyone, and welcome to the session where I'm actually going to walk you through the solar power installation on our home by Xsolar. So first of all, a big thanks to Xsolar because they certainly did put a lot of time and effort into the installation, and it certainly is working like a charm. I must say I'm really pleased with what it is delivering. So what I want to do is walk you through all the individual components, explain why I chose them and what their function is and how well that all worked together. And then I'll end up by kind of giving you some facts and figures in terms of what can make a system viable like this, in particular in South Africa, and potentially the challenges that you might have to deal with. So let's go and have a look on the roof at the main business end of it and have a look at the panels. Right, so as you'll have seen there's a full array of about 9 panels in total. Each of them is 250 watts, so that's a total of 2,250 watts. Now, I was very fortunate. I've done a bit of research on the performance of solar panels, and I have certainly seen that there's a benefit to getting monocrystalline panels. Now, initially when I spoke to Xsolar and put the order in, I thought I might end up with multi-crystalline or polycrystalline panels, because unfortunately sometimes you just have to put up with what the supplier has. But I was very fortunate that when they went to collect the panels, they were monocrystalline. Now, the monocrystalline panels tend to perform, from my research anyway, tend to perform far better under low light conditions and do fairly well under heat compared to polycrystalline. There's a small difference, it's not huge, so if you can get your polycrystalline panels at a cheaper price, then certainly that is a consideration or a route to go. But the other consideration to take is obviously to make sure that your panels aren't shaded during the day. Shading on these panels will dramatically reduce their performance. Now, all of my panels are tied together in what's called a single string in series. So that's done so that I can achieve a high voltage, a high DC voltage, so that the cables that I require to take the power back to the inverter, they don't have to be really thick cables. If you have high current, you need thick cables, but if you've got a high voltage and a low current, you can afford to run thinner cables, which is a consideration. Now, the other consideration to take into account is the angle that you're going to set your panels at and the direction. Now, obviously in the northern hemisphere, you're going to have them facing south, and here in the southern hemisphere in South Africa, you want to have them facing north, as best north as possible, and obviously out of the shade. Now, for most of the day, my panels are out of the shade. There is a tree behind me over there, which in the late afternoon, which is right at the tail end of my power generation, a shadow is cast just on the first few panels. So that's not a huge problem for me, because that's the tail end of the power generation anyway. The angle of the panels. Now, my panels, although I don't know whether you can realize it, they're actually sitting quite high. Down here in Cape Town in South Africa, the kind of perhaps ideal average angle would be around 33 degrees. My panels are angled up at 45 degrees. Now, that was my choice. That angle is particularly good for the winter, because obviously the sun is lower in the sky, so you're going to get better power generation from those panels during winter. And obviously, because winter is the time when you're going to get the least amount of sun, I'm trying to gain as much benefit as I can for that time of the year. During summer, I'm going to have these will generate far more power than I can use, and at the moment, because I cannot feed back onto the grid, I'm trying to cater as best I can for winter. So that's something you need to weigh up for yourselves in terms of the placement and the angle of your panels. So here we are at the inverters, which take the DC power that come from the solar panels and convert it into AC power, which is used for the house. Now, as you can see, I've got these two Victron Energy inverters. Now, an inverter converts DC current into AC current, which can be used in a house. The reason I have two inverters is as follows. This inverter over here is purely there to be able to feed power into the batteries and charge them, and also take the power from the batteries when required, turn it into AC power to feed the house. Now the power that comes off the solar panels on the roof comes into this grid tie inverter. And this grid tie inverter takes the DC power and directly turns it into AC power so that it can feed the house. It doesn't have to go into the batteries first. Now on some systems you have a battery charge controller and the solar panels feed directly into that. That's for a typical house. A grid connected house is not the most efficient system. So that's why I have a grid tie which feeds the grid into the house, and then this can take the power from that and charge the batteries if required. At night time what I do is I've got this Victron Energy Quattro. Can be programmed or configured to react to certain conditions. So at night time I've set it up with some logic so that it will disconnect the mains feed from the energy company, and then it will run the house off the batteries. And under certain conditions during the day, like today when we're generating a lot of power, it will also disconnect the mains feed so that we don't feed back onto the grid, because at this point in time we cannot go back onto the grid through our prepaid meter. So it disconnects the grid and it uses all that power to recharge the batteries and then feed the house and run during the day. And that 2,200 watt array or 2,250 watt array is more than sufficient to run the house and charge the batteries on a good sunny day like today. We're kind of approaching the end of September, so we're still in spring. We're certainly not near our peak amount of sun hours for this time of year. That'll obviously be towards the end of December. But this system will still generate just over 13 kilowatt hours of energy for the house on a good sunny day. On an overcast and rainy day, it'll still generate about 4 kilowatt hours of energy. So I must say, I'm very pleased with that performance. And on a day when it's kind of on and off, you're gonna at least see 67 kilowatt hours. Now, on a hot day like today, we're approaching midday. This system reaches its peak anywhere between 11 o'clock and about 1:30 in the afternoon. Now, on a hot day like today, you probably get to see a peak power output of about 2,000 to 2,100 watts, and that's because of the heat. The heat on the panels does reduce the power output, and that's why it's very interesting to see on a day where it's cool and overcast, you can see these panels going up to as much as 2,600 watts because they are being cooled. Also, that cloud cover, and this was an interesting question someone posed to me, that cloud cover disperses the light. So because you get that dispersed light, you actually get more light in the sky, and that can also give you quite a high power output, even though it's either hazy or there are clouds in the sky. So it doesn't mean to say because there are clouds, you're going to not have power. Under certain conditions, if you've got a bright sky with clouds dispersing the light, your power actually goes up. Now, I reckon that this system during the summertime, we will have, at this point in time, from 8:30 in the morning, we can disconnect from the grid because we've got enough power to run the house right through until about 4 o'clock, 4:30. I reckon in summer, that'll be anywhere from 7 o'clock through to 6 o'clock at night. And this should supply in the region, I reckon, of 15 to 16 kilowatt hours, if not more. So it's certainly going to help us a long way. Now, this kind of system does tend to get expensive when you've got that big bank of batteries and this other inverter. So these systems can be made cheaper if you can feed back onto the grid by just having the solar panels and a grid tie inverter. You also need all the safety bits and pieces involved. We've got a panel here of breakers which can disconnect the system from the house. There's also that little box I showed a little sneak peek into. There are some big breakers for the batteries. The batteries hold a lot of energy in DC current, and that can be very dangerous. So you definitely need a set of fuses and a breaker that can cater if there is any problem at all for safety. Right, so I'm just about to show you our DB board. What I just thought I'd just point out is this is a very handy energy meter that I have. It's produced by a gent called Clinton, who actually lives not too far away. And from here, you can actually see the power. This measures the power that we're drawing from Eskom, or our power company at the moment. It's almost nothing. That's because we are disconnected from the grid. The average power, you can see it mentions there 9.2 kilowatt hour in the last 24 hours that we've used. Now that is actually higher than it has been because we did have quite a few days of rain. But I would normally be sitting at about anywhere from 18 to 28 kilowatt hour had it not been for that array. So even in under, say, rainy conditions, it's doing a great job. We now get away with probably anywhere between, during at this point in spring, only using 3 to 5 kilowatt hours of power, whereas on a sunny day normally I'd be using up to 18 kilowatt hours. So it certainly is proving itself. Right, so what I want to point out is that this is our prepaid meter, and this is where our challenge lies in terms of not being able to feed out through the grid at the moment. It is changing in South Africa. They are going to develop prepaid meters which are set up for solar systems where you'll gain credits when you feed back. But at the moment, if we feed back, I will actually be charged for feeding back because it doesn't know which way the power is going into it. Now, another very critical part of a system like this is a battery monitor. And this is a Victron Energy battery monitor. And this monitors the amount of charge which is going into your batteries and being removed from your batteries. Now this, it's quite intelligent because it can also tell you how much time you've got left if you are running off the batteries and the state of charge of your batteries. This kind of system is critical if you have made a large investment financially in a battery bank, because if you don't treat your battery bank correctly, you can damage it very quickly and then you've written off that investment. So this at least allows you to monitor it and make sure you're not abusing it and running it at suitable levels, so at least you can get many, many years use out of it. Now this piece of equipment I'll go into more detail with when I start doing tutorials and training videos on Victron Energy specific pieces of equipment. So that will be coming soon. Right, so the other thing I want to point out is obviously when you have a system like this, you're going to have it wired into your distribution board in your house. And the one consideration to take is to have a transfer switch between your solar power or your inverter and your main grid feed. If you don't have a transfer switch in a system like this, and if you ever have a fault on your inverter, well then all the power will go down to your house until you can actually have it figured out. So this allows a bypass in case of a situation if there's a fault on the inverter, which is really handy and certainly a recommendation. You certainly want a skilled electrician to be involved in your installation of your solar power system, because they need to know how to hook in your existing household system, and because potentially you might have problems which exist in your household which could cause a problem with the installation. I certainly had a few and I needed to get those resolved, but fortunately it's all come together and it's all working 100% now. Right, so here I'm showing you a view of a piece of software which pulls the information from the grid tie inverter to show you what you're pulling in from your solar panels. So at the moment, as you can see, we've got an instantaneous power of about 1,950 watts coming in. It shows you your total energy for the day. We've already produced 6.1 kilowatt hour and we've hit about midday. And this shows you the total energy that the system. So since the beginning of September, although we weren't fully online at the beginning of September, we've produced 195.4 kilowatt hours. Now, so this is quite handy because you can keep a log with the various products you get from Victron Energy. You can use products where you can obviously log your usage and export these to the internet and have them logged on a Victron Energy website if need be. It's entirely up to you. Now this piece of software I'm showing you is generally not available to the end user of a system. This is used to configure that big quattro inverter. The reason this software generally isn't available for the end user is that any settings which are not set correctly can damage your battery bank or your system. So it is meant for the kind of engineers or what have you. I've got access to this so that I've been able to set things up to make sure my system works correctly so that it doesn't feed back to the grid and that I can automate the usage of when the batteries are used or not. So it tells you what you're bringing in from your power company, which at the moment you can see I'm not there's 0 amps coming in from the power company. And as you can see at the moment, there's no power even being drawn out from the battery bank because all the power is being supplied by the solar panels themselves. You can see the voltage of the battery bank as it's being charged, and at the moment, the battery bank is being fed with about 1920 amps because it's recharging from its use during the course of last night. So at the moment, the house is fully running off the solar power and we're charging, putting 20 odd amps back into the system. Now, what the system has, as I said, these are the more advanced tools. There are something called assistants, which you can configure the actual Quattro for, where you can actually set parameters on what it should do. And just as an example, I'll show you, for instance, I've got this set up so that it'll bring back the Eskom or our main power company grid if there's a draw of 2000 watts or more for 10 minutes, or if the voltage falls below 49.6 volts for 7 minutes. Now, the reason I set these, they're very, very particular to our household. I've basically set up the system so that I say at night, if we go below 650 watts, it'll then switch over to the battery bank for the night. But if we do hit a low point, then it'll bring back the main grid. But in the morning, I don't necessarily want to bring back the grid so that we start charging from the grid because I want to charge from the solar panels. So what I've set up is so that if, for instance, the one high power device which will be switched on in the morning is a kettle, I know our kettle takes 5 to 6 minutes to boil. So I've set this up for about 7 minutes. So I'm allowing the system to do a little bit of a draw, and it might go below my predetermined point under load for 7 minutes. So for within the time that I can boil the kettle. If it goes longer, then fair enough, I bring back the grid. And I've got a whole host of parameters like that which I've configured to automate when the grid is brought in and when we disconnect from the grid. One of those parameters which is set to disconnect the grid is when the load that the inverter sees is approaching less than 200 watts for 30 seconds. So you might have the house using 1000 watts, but you've got 1200, 1200, 1300 watts being pushed out by the roof. And that means you're going to start pushing back onto the grid. And when you hit that condition, this basically tells it to disconnect so that I'm not being charged for electricity that's being pushed back onto the grid itself. Okay, so I dearly hope you found that little tour of value. I will be going into a lot more detail on the individual components as I kind of do little tutorials and how to set them up. Those tutorials are for people who are perhaps specifically installers, but hopefully that overview gives you some idea of what's involved in a solar power system like this. Now, the viability of a system in terms of the financial cost and the payback period does vary from country to country. Here in South Africa, at this point in time, there are no rebates for systems like this, so they do tend to be a little more expensive. But as I said, there is the possibility of not having the battery bank, not having that one big inverter, and just having the solar panels and the grid tie inverter, which will seriously reduce the cost of the system, and potentially these systems now can start paying for themselves very soon. As you've seen, there is a lot of specialized equipment involved, and the installation needs to be done by people who know what they're doing. So I would say if you are looking at bigger systems like this to run your house efficiently, if it's for one, it can be dangerous if you don't know what you're doing, and if they're not installed properly, they won't perform. So my advice is certainly do go and have a look at Exsolar's website. I'll put the details below. They certainly have a broad range of equipment and expertise to help you with these different systems. I am currently running a video series on how to solar power your house to kind of go step for step in terms of understanding the considerations you need to take into account. And I'll add a link up here to that first video, and that series will be continuing over the next coming weeks and months in terms of what you require. If you do have any questions about the system that I have or about the equipment, then certainly do post a note below and I'll get back to you. And as I said, all the details of the system will be down below in the details of the video. Thanks very much for watching, and certainly if you do gain any value and enjoy this video, then certainly do subscribe, share it with your friends, and give it a thumbs up. Thanks very much for watching.